Okay, everybody, here I am. I'm trying my new format, hands-free horizontal layout, as my mentor had taught me. My video mentor told me I had to do it like this, so I'm giving it a shot. Today I was thinking about, we had just gotten through, I have a buyer that I'm working with that obviously is buying a home, and we did all our inspections, and obviously, in most places, you have air conditioning and roofs, and in this case, we had a chimney, right? A chimney that we were dealing with. What else? Plumbing, electrical. You know, so you get your primary home inspection, and after you get your home inspection, and sometimes even as you're planning your original home inspection, you will also plan to have the roofer out if you're looking at some things. You're like, man, I see some leaking here. Let's call the roofer ahead of time. Let's call the plumber ahead of time because we already see issues. But sometimes you don't really know, you don't see things. So you get the home inspector there first, and after the home inspection, he'll say, well, we saw this plumbing issue or this roof issue or this electrical issue and HVAC, which is air handler, air conditioning issues. And then at that point, you get the experts to come out and test your HVAC. Now in Corpus Christi, I believe more often than not, the home warranty companies are requesting that you have a professional air handler, air HVAC, air conditioning, you know, heating expert service the unit before closing, because if it was already dying or it was already dead or already had these issues before closing, they may or may not cover you. They might, but more and more they may not. So just to protect your client and yourself, even sellers, you know, this is gonna happen. Be prepared for it, okay? Maybe, I always tell the seller, look, I know you don't wanna spend the money on inspections before selling your home, but it's up to you if you want surprises, right? If you've maintained your air conditioning and you've had it serviced and you clean the coils regularly and you know your roof is okay and you know your plumbing's okay, and then you go, no big deal, fine, just go, you know? You may or may not be surprised. But when you're in the option period here in Texas, it was a little different in Hawaii. In Hawaii, we had, was it C-51, paragraph C-51. And in paragraph C-51, you had a 14-day inspection period, okay, in which you can do inspections and back out and be protected. Okay, in Corpus Christi, we have what's called the option period, was often called the inspection period. And that option period is a time that you and the buyer determine that you need to do your inspections and or finalize your financing, okay? I don't go into deals unless I know their financing's okay, but even if you're close and you're really close on your financing, you have that 10, I usually do 10 days. You have 10 to, you know, 12 days. If you ask for 14, that's kind of pushing it, okay? So you get your financing, you get your inspections done, and when you're negotiating through the inspection period, buyer or seller, you really need to kind of stand back from any kind of emotional reaction, okay? If you're buying a new home, you have to make sure it's new and it doesn't have issues. There's so many times when you buy new homes and it's not because the builder's bad, but you know, the builder can't oversee every little tiny thing and things will happen. That's why you have a home inspection on a new home. Okay, and on older homes, you can't go in and say, okay, I want this 10-year-old home and I want you to give it to me in the condition of a new home. I want it graded. I want new fixtures, or I want fresh paint, or I want a new, you know, this, that, the other, because I want it. You don't go into it like that. You go into it going, okay, I recognize that this is an older home, and as long as what I see is what I get, I'm okay moving ahead. But then when you have these issues come up, like in our case recently, we knew the air handler was old. Okay, but we were like, oh, it's working fine. We guess it's working okay. And you know, seems to be functioning okay. But when we had the professionals come out and check the electrical currents and the fan and give it the full service deal, the air conditioning HVAC guy says, you know, I hate to tell you this, but when they start pulling energy like this, and surging and pulling a lot of energy, they're about to die. You know, he says, I bet my life this thing's gonna die on you by summer. Now, that's a pretty strong statement. You know, I know there are salesmen out there that try to sell them and when you don't need them, but my clients know they worked with these guys before, and they're not just saying that to be dramatic or get a new air handler job, you know, make some money. They were like, be careful, you know? And so in light of that, me and the buyers were really bummed out because we didn't plan on asking for an air handler, a new interior and exterior air handler. Okay, we say, what is it, air handler, and then the exterior unit. Okay, so we were at a point where a couple days later we went back in and it wasn't functioning properly. And so we basically turned in an amendment and said, you know, look, we are very sorry that we have to be the bearer of bad news. And we were not intending on doing this. And in light of what he told us a few days ago, the professionals, and the fact that we came back and it's already dying, we really know that we have to ask for a new air handler and interior and exterior units. And the reason I'm sharing with you what we said and how we said it is because we as buyers need to be very respectful and aware of what the sellers are dealing with. Okay, when you're a seller, you feel like everybody's criticizing you and they're coming at you and, well, this is wrong, or we need this, or we want that, or we don't like the paint, and you feel like you're being criticized all the time. And, you know, unfortunately for sellers, there are buyers and agents out there that will try to milk you for everything you've got, okay, and manipulate and kind of bait and switch. They know they're going to ask for this, but they're going to pretend like they're not, and then they get in and then they start driving you crazy, okay? So with that being said, I do not like to do that. And I tell my clients, I am not doing that. I will not do that. I will not manipulate. I will not lie. I will not bait and switch. We're going to go in there transparent, honest, and we're going to treat them the way we want to be treated if we were selling a home. Fortunately, my clients had just sold a property for their mother, and they had such a bad experience, and they knew exactly what I was talking about as a seller being criticized and milked for everything. And, you know, like if you didn't give them every little thing, they were going to back out, and they were complaining, and they were so, you know, and rather, and as a seller, you don't want to lose the deal. So you just deal with it a lot of times, and you just accommodate their requests, but you don't want to because it's not fair. So life's not fair. As my son told me, Mom, life's not fair. So with that being said, when you're negotiating through that option period, there are some things that I think everything for the most part can be walked out between buyer and seller. Okay. But if there's a plumbing issue and the seller's not willing to fix it and the buyer can't fix it, you got to walk away. There's foundation issues and seller won't fix it, or buyer, you know, can't fix it or whatever. You can't move on with that. Okay. But if they're willing to fix it, you can move through anything. But the point of this video is to, number one, bring to your awareness what you're dealing with in the option period. Okay. You're trying to get your financing and your inspections squared away 100%. I don't do financing. I don't get my financing squared away in the option period because I don't like to write offers unless I know you're pre-approved, like for real, everything's been checked, okay? Every once in a while when I know someone's a strong buyer and we just need a little time, I'll do it. But, you know, when I don't know, I won't write an offer without a pre-approval and until I really know they've had their stuff reviewed. But when you're negotiating in the option period, okay, if you were that seller, what would you want done for you? I mean, do you want to take that air handler that's going to die in 3 months? Is that fair? Are you buying a house that you're going to have to replace a $4,000 air handler in 4 months? Is that what you want to do? Or is that too bad for the seller? I mean, it's not the seller's fault that it's dying, but it sucks to be them, but it's their problem. It's not ours, right? You don't buy a car with a defective, you know, an engine that's going to go out in 3 months for the price that you're going to buy it for with an engine that works, right? So when you approach it respectfully, you approach it as I call it the dance, you know, like you're dancing, you're like give and take and give and take, and you know, they take a step, you take a step. But what was really cool is we gave them the facts, we gave them the information, and they called their air conditioning people. And sure enough, thank God, they were honest. They said the same thing and said, look, we're sorry. Yeah, we replaced the fan, but it really is surging and it's about to die. And we're so sorry. We should have told you about that or noticed that before. And they really do need a new air handler. So the beauty of the situation was we approached them very carefully, very, compassionately, empathetically, where we're trying to put ourselves in their situation and say, look, we aren't trying to get something new from you. We were not intending on doing this, but in light of what we discovered, we really have to ask you for this. And they saw our heart, and they saw that we were telling the truth and we were sincere. And when they got their information, they were like, yeah, okay. And they agreed. So it was stressful because we didn't know if they were going to get mad or frustrated. And not, some people do. Even when it's irrational, they just kind of take it out on you when it's not your fault. But when you're negotiating and you're dealing with these issues, be very, very respectful and put yourself in the other person's position. And if you were being demanded of things, and even though we weren't demanding, we were asking, saying we have to have this, you know, but I find that you build a good relationship with the other agent and the other party when you are straightforward, honest, you do your homework, you do your research, you present it to them and say, look, I'm sorry to be the bearer of bad news, but this is what we're dealing with. And we trust that we can, you know, find a resolution and move forward. Okay. So with that being said, don't give up in the option period. Don't freak out. Don't get pissed off. If they do try to play games, just keep being gracious and say, look, I'm sorry, this is unfair for you. But as you know, you don't sell a car with a bad engine for the same price. You know, you have to fix the engine. You know, and I try to think of analogies because it helps me. So with that being said, have an awesome day. that's it. Okay. Wow. Bye.